Orbital Starship mission will feature a propulsive landing of the Super Heavy booster. Presumably, on its feet, followed by a Starship splashdown in the Pacific Ocean about an hour and 20 minutes later. At first glance, the splashdown seems kind of odd for a company that's been softly touching down Falcon 9 first stage rockets on their landing legs since 2015, and even setting down this behemoth gently on the landing pad in Starbase, Texas before we get into the landings that SpaceX has planned for our Starship's first orbital flight. Let's go over the mission step by step, so that the whole family can understand why there are even two landings in the first place. Space missions have timelines that are based on liftoff time, you know, the classic T-10, 9, 8, and after you get to zero, the timer starts to count up with T-plus, 1, 2, 3, and so on. From SpaceX's FCC filing, we can see that the booster will cut off its engines separate from Starship, and then the Starship's engines will fire. All before the 3-minute mark, the booster will touch down, about 6 minutes later, and the Starship's engines will shut down. Shortly after that, by the time the Starship will have brought its speed up to orbital velocity, giving it enough momentum to coast all the way around the planet without additional propulsion, it's helpful that the FCC filings show this green line on the image to indicate the ground space underneath the flight path. The flight path around, just make sure to only rotate it and not move it, because the center of an orbit always needs to be at the center of the Earth, no matter what the orbit's inclination is, plus or minus a few real-world anomalies like lumpy gravity concentrations and things like that. So when the mission is all said and done, it will take the Starship about 90 minutes total to travel east from Texas, go around the globe, and splash down near Hawaii in the Pacific Ocean. Some people are probably wondering how the time adds up, because the ISS, which also travels at orbital speed, takes around 90 minutes itself to circle the Earth. It appears that even though the ISS gets a head start, because it's already at orbital speed at the beginning of each orbit, as opposed to the Starship, which you know launches completely stationary at Starbase, Texas, the difference is made up by Starship not making a full orbit, but instead only traveling about 3/4 of the way around the Earth during its 90-minute flight. So during the Starship's 90-minute flight, the Earth will have turned a little more than 22 degrees. Obviously, this isn't being shown in real time, because a 90-minute video would be crazy. When Starship splashes down at the end of the mission, it will be out in the water, with no platform to land on, and nothing to catch it. So what's the big idea? Well, first of all, this is a SpaceX test vehicle. SpaceX does this radical thing that other space companies don't really do, called rapid prototyping. They're trying to build an affordable and mass-producible vehicle in the first place. So they would rather lose the hardware in a failure than lose the time figuring out all the failure modes the long way. But one of the biggest reasons for landing in the ocean and not on land is human safety. SpaceX doesn't want to needlessly put lives at risk on Earth for Mars missions. On the other hand, Elon has said that people will probably die, and I'm eager to see what those risks look like. Why the orbital Starship doesn't try to land in Starbase, Texas, like it has before, that's because the orbital flight test landing won't be coming in from an almost straight up and down trajectory like the previous prototype test flights. The Starship will be coming in sideways, and it'll have all of its orbital speed along with it. When it re-enters the atmosphere, to play it the safest, it needs to re-enter the atmosphere somewhere over the ocean in case something goes wrong. If there is some sort of failure with this experimental spacecraft that relies on experimental systems like its brand new thermal protection system, they're going to try to put this orbital Starship prototype down after its flight is clearly well thought out. It's right in the middle of the Pacific, where the re-entry portion of the flight will happen over the ocean. Such a trajectory will ensure that any debris will end up in the ocean if something goes wrong, and the splashdown site will be a safe distance away, but still very close to the Hawaiian island of Kauai. This will presumably allow SpaceX to recover the Starship and gain potentially priceless information, while all keeping everyone safe and not having to deal with international hurdles, because Hawaii is part of the United States. Now that we've talked about Starship landing in the water, I think it's time we talked about Starship's Super Heavy booster landing. Think it'll just end up in the water as well, like this Falcon 9 booster did. I'll tell you a little bit about Super Heavy booster's role in the orbital test flight though, and for those of you just learning about space flight. The SpaceX Starship is divided into two stages, So far every single rocket that has made it into orbit has been a multi-stage rocket. This is because the Earth's gravity is super strong. Also, the Earth's atmosphere is super thick, in comparison to the vacuum of space. The Starship's first stage is known as the Super Heavy Booster, and it has the same job as the Falcon 9's first stage shown here, which is to accelerate the upper stage, and payload as fast as it possibly can towards orbital speed. Before it runs out of propellant, you can think of it like the first stage of throwing the second stage into space. Of course, the Falcon 9 second stage is designed to be discarded and burn up in the atmosphere after single use, and the SpaceX Starship, even though it goes orbital as well, is designed to do the opposite and re-enter the atmosphere safely and land and be reused during a launch. Super Heavy won't be able to bring the entire mass of a Starship up to orbital speed all by itself, meaning if the Starship didn't light its own engines and use its own propellant, it would fall back down right in the Caribbean Sea. But Super Heavy will get Starship literally on its way, not only in terms of distance traveled, which doesn't actually matter, but more importantly, it will give Starship a good chunk of the momentum it needs to get into orbit, since the orbital test flight will be similar to a Falcon 9 RTLS mission. The booster will perform a boost back burn after stage separation. I'm sure you noticed the big vertical loop in the flight path. It's worth pointing out that this is a much more realistic motion for the booster than what we've seen in previous official SpaceX animations. So the booster just turning around and canceling out all of its momentum, using perfectly retrograde thrust. In reality, a booster would have so much prograde momentum that if it tried to cancel out its forward motion and effectively stop on a dime and turn around and go the other way, it would begin to fall downwards during that process. So instead of perfectly opposite thrust to the direction the booster is traveling, the booster will point its thrust in a way that alters its forward course to go up and around, giving it time to get into position for landing back towards the direction of the launch site. Eventually, the booster will fire a landing burn and presumably attempt to touch down on a landing platform in the Gulf of Mexico on one of their football field size that SpaceX has in service for their Falcon 9 boosters. But their new oil rig platforms will be in service soon, and I wouldn't be surprised to see them operational and floating out in the Gulf by the time this mission happens. SpaceX has canceled Thursday's road closure, likely pushing Super Heavy's first attempt at a static fire test into next week. After an apparent false start on Wednesday morning, SpaceX has distributed a second safety alert among Boca Chica residents in anticipation of the first static fire of a Super Heavy booster as early as July 15th. Thanks for watching this video, and it's a super interesting topic. If you like this, make sure to subscribe. If you have any crazy ideas about what we should cover in next video, please comment it below, and we'll see if we can get to it. So thanks again for watching and goodbye.